Tell me what that means to you. Any trouble?
Aaron, I would say it's more of a, instead of, you're keeping it in a certain order instead of you're controlling it instead of trying to keep everybody in one area.
Okay. Anyone else?
Be more proactive than me.
Very good. Okay. We used to sit back and see what the teams gave us, and then we determine how we're going to referee. Right? But that puts in a lot of problems because every game is different. And what do coaches want?
Consistency.
Right? So when we're calling the game differently from city to city or from night to night, we're getting in trouble. So FEMA said, we want the referees every night to be the same. It doesn't matter who's working the game, what crew's on the game, we want the same things called. What does FIBA look at, or what does Canada West or OUA look at to determine how the game is called? What are some of the things that look at that we get at the start every year? Points of emphasis. If we do a good job with points of emphasis in games, we're going to have a pretty good game. We get in trouble in games when we don't do a good job of points of emphasis. So in this presentation, I'm going to just talk about some things. And I was saying to read in the back, Coach Jacobson tied into my presentation perfectly because he's talking about some of the same things that I'm going to talk about and that others in this room have talked about this morning. Right? Matt talked about getting things right the first time. Okay? Basketball is a simple game. It's a tough game to referee, but as referees, if we get the calls right, we're going to have good game control. Right? Coaches are going to be happy. All the little things that we do in the game are going to make it important for us. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about what we can do to have good game control. And game control starts. It starts with leaders. And Coach talked a little bit about leadership when he addressed our group. Okay? How do we become a leader? Leaders aren't born, they're made. How many people want to be ours in this room? You better all put your damn hands up. Put your hands up. Okay? We need ours in Canada West. We need ours in OUAA. We need people that are going to step up and be leaders for the next 20 years. Okay. If you look back in, with the exception of Matt, Ponzi, because he's going to beat me up if I say this, and Reed, I guess, there's some elderly people back there. I'm not back there, so I can say that. Yeah. That group is going to be not going to be on the scene for much longer. Okay? We need people to step up and be leaders. How do we become strong leaders on and off the court? Okay? We're not basketball referees. We had a discussion at lunch about teachers. You're a teacher 24/7. You're in the public eye as a referee 24/7. How you conduct yourself off the court, reflects on, people see. So you gotta think about that. How can I be a leader on the court? If I know the rules, if I know the mechanics of basketball, if I know the little things I don't have to think about, I can concentrate on refereeing the basketball game. That'll be a good game control. So for me, I try to get everything out of my mind, right? We've had a long day, we're coming to the gym, people have worked all day, now we're going to the game. How do we get mentally ready for the game? It's really, really critical in how we're going to have a good game. So the mental preparation. So get rid of all the distractions so you can focus on refereeing the game. It's hard to do. Right? You're going to have to find, it means when I get in the car, I go in the game. I get in basketball mode. I'm starting to think about the game, what kind of game we're going to have, who the coaches are, right? If you've done it close one or two, three times, five times, 10 times, you know what kind of game it's going to be, right? Some coaches are explosive, are very explosive, and we have to talk about that in the pregame, how we're going to handle it. What do we need to do each game so we have good game control? Okay, where does it start? Where does our game control start? Pregame. It starts in the pregame. We have to talk about all the things that will happen in the game. Okay. Right now, there's tape on mine. At the university level, at the college level, lots of guys are going to go. If I'm ref at Brandon and Winnipeg, I'm going to probably look at some tape of those people playing before I'm refing. I'm going to look at some tape. If I haven't seen them on your ass for a couple of years, I'm going to look at some tape. I'm not going to watch the whole fun just to look at and see what they do. It's gonna help us prepare for every meeting. Take care of little things first. Know the rules, okay? Bill says I don't know the rules. I know most of them. I do. I really know most of them. And the ones I don't know, as I told this morning, I just don't call. Okay? So be fit. Be fit so you can come to court. It's tough if you have to think about, I'm not fit enough that I can get to accept the play, so I'm worried about my condition. But be fit. One thing you don't have to worry about. Be emotionally ready to referee. Coach talked about that. What does he want in one senior referee? Someone that's approachable. Someone that doesn't lose their mind when the coach screams at them. Okay? Sometimes, how many people here have coached basketball? Okay? It's tough to coach basketball, right? You get frustrated when kids miss layups. You get frustrated when you say, what number do you have? And the kid looks down and goes 12. First year coaching. First year teaching. I said, we had a timeout. And this kid, I'm at a 7-9 school in Calgary. And I say, Renato, what number do you have? 12. This happens through seasons. So we have to know that. Emotionally ready to referee. How are we going to handle the game? Have fun on the court. We don't make a lot of money. Karen, where's Karen?
She went to the bank.
She went to the bank, she counted the money. She did 60. Mike, what's the fee now? $2,500?
Oh, that's pretty low for most of
them. Yeah, well, U.S. money is a lot of money, okay? It's a lot of, they make a lot of dough. They earn it, they work hard, okay? They have a tough schedule, but they get paid a lot of money. We don't get paid a lot of money. We have fun on the court. What I like to see if I'm supervising the game, I love seeing the referee laugh, smile, good call, okay? I like to be able to laugh at myself. If I've kicked a call, I'm not gonna show the people that are coaching, but when we get in a huddle, the three of us, I'll say, you know what, that last call, Marla, the one that I missed, I had a double dribble, it wasn't a double dribble. And I'll laugh at you. I hope I don't have another one. Right? Coaching can give you a hard time, so I don't know what they're watching. Good referees that have good game control, look for feedback, and also accept it. Sometimes people say, hey, can you watch the game and give me some feedback? And then you give them the feedback, they're like, yeah, but no, you didn't really see that. Not ready to accept it. All right, and one thing this weekend we'd like you to do, it's a smorgasbord. That's what this whole weekend is. You pick and choose what you want to put in your game. Right? You pick and choose. I like this, I'm going to put it in my game. I don't like that, I'll put it in your game. So pick and choose the things that you want to put in your game to make your game better. Because you've heard a lot, you're going to get a lot of information about the game. Challenge of leadership. Be strong, but not rude. And every one of us are different in how we interact with people and coaches and players. So you've got to find this. Be kind, but not rude. Be bold, but not a bully. Be thoughtful, but not lazy. Be humble, but not timid. Be proud, but not arrogant. And have a sense of humor. Karen and I did a game at UBC 4 years ago.
Yeah.
It was, who was our third partner?
I don't know.
And one of the coaches was a complete arsehole. Okay? And Karen came over, and the first time I was like, oh my God, this is driving me crazy. And I said, what is the effing arsehole, Karen? She laughed for about 2 minutes.
Oh my
God. She went out the court, and she still laughed. She goes, oh my God, that just made my day. I'm like, but he is. Like, it just described him perfectly. So if we can't laugh at ourselves on the court, I mean, would I say that to the coach? No. Not right, correct. If we can't laugh at ourselves and have fun on the court, we're not doing a good job. This is FIBA's philosophy. Be in charge with a service attitude. Okay? We're part of the game, we're not the game. Right? We're an important part of the game. What's the best compliment official can get after a game? I don't know who the referees were that ref that game. Why don't you? Didn't notice them in the game. Perfect compliment. Perfect ultimate compliment. Didn't record. Didn't even notice them. Game went on. It was great. That's what we want to do. Confident trust. Have to have it in the referee team. Coaches, fans notice when there's friction on the court. Okay? We have to be a unit, right? It doesn't mean we agree with everything that's on the court, but we're on the court, we're a unit. And one another on the court, and it looks like hell. And it really looks, and coaches pick up on that, and that's the divide and conquer. Now they can divide and conquer you when they're talking to you at different times. Like, Kerry's doing a good job, Rick, your other partner, Rick, is off. Like, that's, you know, that's what they can do, because they sense that on the court.
John, why do you keep picking on me?
I've only done it once. I've never really been...
Well, you said I was the old guy in the back room a minute ago.
You got trouble in the crew. Get trouble in the crew.
Yeah, good chemistry.
Trouble in the crew.
Here's an example right now.
You got to bring in the referee, TC.
One of the things that we don't think about a lot of the time are non-verbal cues on the court, right? How we stand when we talk to coaches, right? How we stand on the court when we're warming up, right? When we talk to the players, when we're over at the timeout. Those non-verbal cues are really important. So when you're looking at what Karen and Matt and Marla are breaking down today with you, look at how you're standing on the court. Okay? Are you tall? Are you standing strong? Okay? Do you have good signals? Really important. Okay, composure. Coach Jacobson talks about composure. All right? Our composure, if we lose our composure, we're done. We're completely done. We lose credibility. Coaches don't believe in us. We're in trouble with our partners. We lost the game. Okay? And we don't ever want that to happen. We talk about pregame. It doesn't matter how many games you work, how many times I've worked with Michael or Rick or Warren or Karen or Matt, we always have a pregame. We always have a pregame. We always talk about a number of things that might happen in the game. My rule, if we talk about it, it won't happen. So I usually try to talk about fights and overtime. I don't want either of those things to happen. If we talk about it, my rule is it doesn't happen. Usually, I haven't had an overtime game in 5 years.
37 years.
Because my partners, as a referee, we've got to be proactive. We have to know the temperature. Bill talked a little bit about this profile. The temperature on the game. We have to know before an incident happens. And what are our cues on the court? How do we know that players aren't happy? I'm asking you. Tell me what. How do we know that players aren't happy? What's the first thing they do?
They move for you.
No. They give you this. Right? They turn around and give you that. What? They haven't been doing it all game. Someone gives me the what? Okay. I'm not the right guy in the world. But now my antenna goes up. Okay, there's something going on. I'll let my crew know. Okay, we might be missing something in the post. We might be doing hand check, right? We're missing something. Okay. If a player comes up and says, "Hey, ref, I'm getting pounded in the post." Okay. What am I going to do with that? I'm going to share that with my partner. Hey, guys, 12 White said this post play is really rough. Let's have a look. He might be right about it. Let's have a look. So that proactive piece, we never want the situation to escalate up here. We want to get it early. How can we, if the game is getting a little rough, what can we do to get the game back when we need it? Simple, really simple. No. Blow your whistle. Right? Blow your whistle. A couple of fouls at each end. All of a sudden, it was like, oh, okay, I'm done. We're done. Okay? We don't want that game to get out of control. That proactive part of it. A good referee can prevent or anticipate. Not all the time. But the more games that you do, the more experience you get, the better you are at looking at what might happen in the game. Game intelligence. 4 or 5 people today have talked about this. Do we know the foul count? The direction of the arrow. How much time is on the game clock and 24 seconds clock? Okay? We have to know those things. Are we aware of what's going on with the benches? Do we have a coach that's running up and down the sidelines and we haven't really looked? He hasn't really bothered us, but really it's an irritant to the game because we have a coach sitting on the bench, like he'll talk about today, and it's very quiet. But we got to know what's going on with the benches. Do we recognize tempo changes? What's a tempo change?
Speed of the game.
Speed of the game. What can cause a tempo change?
Lead change.
Lead changes.
Big play.
Big plays? What kind of big plays usually?
Fast breaks.
Fast breaks. Dunks. three-point shot. Nice defensive play, block, okay? A rough post play. Those are all things that can change the tempo of the game. We gotta recognize that. We gotta know what's going on. Talk a little bit today, again, about, do we recognize what teams are doing? Are they playing zone? Are they full-court pressing? Is it a zone press? Do we have to have center a little bit deeper in the backcourt so that they can cover the press better? Okay? We gotta recognize all those things. High screens, okay? Biggest change in basketball, in my opinion, in the last 5 years is there's so much screening above the free throw line. Okay? Above the free throw line. And we're getting way, if you chart fouls above the free throw, we're seeing way more fouls above the free throw line. 10 years ago, the ball always been in the post. The ball doesn't go in the post ever at all anymore, right? 3-point line is a big factor of that. But we gotta be rid of referee outside the top of the circle. Conflicts. Most basketball games have conflicts. Okay, how do we manage conflict? The best way to manage conflict is your approach is in solving. Okay? Am I approachable? Can I talk to these? Someone said, do you talk to the players? Absolutely. I like to talk to the players a lot. But I also like to be proactive. So if the game is getting a little bit intense and we're on a free throw, this is what I might do. The administering officials will come in, and usually we talk about, well, we want to have a good game pace, but I'm going to come in, I'm going to dribble the ball a few times, and I'm going to say, fellas, we don't want to have to call any more fouls in post, but let's make sure we're clean.
Okay.
Right? I'm going to look at 14, I'm going to look at 22. Yeah? Okay, 14, okay, 22. I took 10 seconds of game time, or, you know, to do that, but all of a sudden, it went from here to here, and we addressed two of the players. Does it work all the time? No. Does it work most of the time? Absolutely. Worst way to manage conflict is to say, I have to go away. My partner will get it. Yeah, do you know what? If we just get to halftime, it might go away. Or we'll wait to quarter and then talk about it. Then what happens? We get a fight, we get something on the bench. Now we have to do the game report. Your supervisor calls you. Yeah. You didn't take care of business. Right? You didn't control that game. To have a successful game. Points of emphasis. Oh my God. If you look back in the last 20 years, have the points of emphasis changed? Nope. Every year. What are they? Dribbler contact, rough post play,
guard play.
Guard play.
Bench decorum.
Bench decorum. And one more they throw. A fifth one in every year. That's all they do. It's the same. So why do they keep bringing it up? Because we do a shitty job of enforcing them. Right? If they got to keep telling us to do it, usually you do it, and then the next year you can put something new in. We have the same damn ones every year. Why? We don't do a good job. Or we start the year off with it, and then the year goes on, like, yeah, it's okay. We'll let them get, they're a good athlete, we'll let them get beat up in the backcourt. We can't do that. Okay? That all takes place in the pregame, and we gotta do it. If we say we're gonna do it, we gotta do it. And if we're consistent as basketball referees, then every night's gonna be consistent. We don't have to come in and say, Morgan's crew did a good job last night. We didn't, you know, the coach says, well, last night they called me a check. Tonight they're not calling me a check. Right? We don't want coaches to be able to say that to us. We want to enforce the points of emphasis because it helps the game. The reason that there is, it helps the game. Understand the level of play on the court. Okay? Understand what you're refereeing and what these players can do. If there's a little bit of contact as the guy goes to the basket, are we going to blow down it? Are we going to blow down give a foul, put the ball inside, and let it go to the basket? Okay, that comes with experience. You know what? Nothing frustrates a coach more than when we take a basket away for a really soft, cheap call that we kind of made because of the reaction there. Or we weren't there in time to accept the play. We saw, you know, 30% of the frame. As a referee, if there are 15 frames in every play, I don't want to blow my whistle unless I've seen all 15 frames. If I've seen the last 5 frames, I'm not going to get it right. So my philosophy is, I'm not going to blow my whistle and guess. My partner might have to come and help me with that, which is great. You might have seen the whole all 15 frames. It's my fault, though, if I'm not in position and don't get those 15 frames. Consistency, consistency, consistency. coach is possible. You guys aren't being consistent. Often I can throw that word at us, and it means we're not calling enough fouls, put them on the free throw line for the communication, right? But our consistency at both ends of the court, start the game for the free throw. We've got to burn up. Can you start the pregame? And the other part, we have a timeout. You know, lots of timeouts in FIBA. What do we talk about when we get together as a crew and timeout? What should we talk about? What's going to happen? What's happening on the court? Is everybody comfortable with what we're doing? Okay. Do we have any players that we should be looking at for whatever reason? Right? So we're talking basketball things, not where we're going after the game. Good game flow. People want to have good game flow. They want the game to go up and down. If we enforce the points of them, it's just left. Referees are in charge of the show. Okay? We're in charge, and we have to be in charge to start the pitch. How can we handle conflict? Listen. Understand. Show a respectful attitude. Make a decision. Shit happens, move on. Let it go. Okay? You can't hold that the rest of the game saying, oh, I don't know what, you did the right thing. You made a decision, move on. Let it go. Sometimes coaches want to bring it up. Some coaches say, hey, coach, we've already talked about that. We're not talking about that anymore. Okay? Things happen. Do we get every call right? Absolutely not. Anyone here had a perfect game? Except for Rick. I saw one game on paper. How was last night?
What's up?
That was 5-0-T that game.
What? Okay.
5-0-T.
Rick played in a game with 5-0-T. Played in a game. What year was that? It was
February in 1980.
1980?
Yeah, Brown University versus Lakeland.
At the Thunderdome.
And he actually made a couple of shots. Missed a free throw, but he was pretty good. Mistakes are part of refereeing. We make a mistake, we got to get it off our line. Right? We all make mistakes. Look at the NBA, the last 2 minutes when they do their last 2 minute report. They have to be the perfect. They can't get a perfect 2 minutes, right? When they show that last 2 minute report. Wow. Okay? The best in the business can't get 2 minutes right. How in the world can you get 4 minutes? Our job is to reduce the mistakes we make. How can we do that? Watching tape. Other referees work. Going to the games and watching and talking to people after the game about the calls they make. Okay? It's so, so important. It's really, really important. And I know people are busy. It doesn't mean you have to watch a whole game tape. It's nice if you can, right? If you can watch a quarter, you can watch 2 quarters, right? Guy named Terry Rokosh. Oh my God, he watches every game, and then he watches other games, and he's amazing, and he gets great clips. He watches every game he refs, start to finish. Writes the report on it, you know, and then he'll send me a couple clips. Say, John, look at this call. What do you think? Or he said to Mike, what do you think? You know, it's just like, holy shit, right? He watches tape, and it just makes him such a better referee. It really does. So we gotta, if we want to get better, we gotta invest some time in ourselves. We gotta watch some tape. Are we proactive in our game control approach? Number one is communication. And it starts when we go over and shake hands with the coach, right? It starts, they size us up like when we go over and shake their hands. We had Bruce Andrews 1 year in Calgary, and he did kind of the same thing Coach Dickinson did. And he said, here's the one thing I want referees to do. When they come over to shake my hand and look me in the eye. Okay. And then someone says, is that all? He goes, that's all I have. Okay. He goes, yep. Say hello. I don't need them to talk to me too much, but just say hello, hi coach, shake my hand and look me in the eye. That's how it starts. So that whole thing about how we project our persona on the court. Start to move over and shake the referee's hand. Coach Jacob is saying, both coaches, Coach Rollick, they look over and see referees. Okay, we're good tonight, or we're in trouble tonight. In a way, that's a little bit frightening because they're going to prejudge what we're going to do that game. You know, even for the good part, like, Rollick, we don't have Have we identified problem players on the court? Okay? If you've done a team two or three times, you know who the problem players are. Right? You all know that. When does a game change often? When do we see a big change in games? When the subs come in. Why do we have change, a big change when the subs come in? Skill level. Absolutely. So what does it turn into? Five-a-side rugby. A lot of the time. Right? Five-a-side rugby. And now we're going to determine how we're going to get through this last 6 minutes of the game, still have a little bit of game flow, right? And these kids are working hard, and they're like, they deserve our best officiating, right? But now we have to step up our game and our crew to understand what we're doing. And that last 6 minutes of the game can be very difficult to referee. And get subs in. Is our crew all on the same page? Okay? And I talked before about, we get together during the timeout and we say, are you comfortable? And I worked with a guy in calls last year. The evaluator was there. And all game, he said, yeah, everything's good, everything's good. And after the game, the evaluator said, so, I'm not gonna use his name. How did you feel? He goes, oh, our post play was way too rough. And I was like, what the fuck did you just say? I just lost it. And I'm like, well, I asked you five times, we talked at halftime, and you never brought it up. And he goes, well, that's my opinion. I'm like, I never want to work with you again. Like, I can't believe that during the game, you would say that to us. And he goes, well, just my opinion. I said, am I that? I'm over that? You can't talk to me? And he said, but I thought the battery would really appreciate that. I said, oh, I'm not working with you ever.
No.
Right? So he was trying to impress the evaluator who said, oh my God, the post play was really well done. Which, of course, he had to say because I lost my mind. Yeah, are we on the same page? And how, if we're not on the same page, what do we do? So when the crew gets together, you get on the court, and we come out to hear your timeouts, we better hear you talking basketball stuff. And we better hear someone say, hey, is everyone comfortable with post play? Are we on the same page? Use basketball terminology, right? How are our rotations, right? We need you to talk and talk basketball in that 30, 40 seconds that you have as a referee. Why? It keeps in the game, number one, right? It refocuses us and makes us better referees. Again, consistency. It's, I can't say it enough. Nonverbal body language. Okay? How we stand, how we react. Some people, when they make a bad call, what do they do? It's half up here. It's like, oh God, I hate that call. Right? When I do a shitty call, it's like, boom! That was awful. I'm saying, what an awful call, but I got a good call, you're 15 on the question. And I'm walking back with that, it's a horrible call. But the book doesn't know it's a horrible call, because I know I kicked the shit out of it, but I'm not going to let anyone know. Right? And then, at the first break, my partner's going, I know it's a horrible call, I'll tell everyone it's horrible. But you didn't, I didn't give it away with my body language. Right? Really important. Be calm and approachable at all times. What did Coach say? I want to be able to talk to someone. Right? Sometimes you just gotta stand and listen. You just gotta listen. Don't have to do it. Then walk away. You're a good listener. You can't get in trouble for what you don't say. Sometimes we wanna have a snappy comeback, or we wanna get the last word. You're gonna lose. Right? You don't need it. You don't need to win the argument. It's not about winning. Right? Sometimes when the folks are really pissed off and I walk away and I go on the other side, I'm like, that's good. That's good. I'm having a good game, our crew's good, and he's really upset for no reason. That's okay. The play gets up here, you gotta be down here. You gotta calm things down. But first you gotta recognize what's happening, right? So if someone on your crew recognizes that intensity is picked up, you better let your crew know. Or if these two players are going at it, you better let your crew know, hey, watch 12 and 14. And I'm going to say so that 12 and 14 here, and that both coaches here. Because then if we have to have a double foul or a T, they'd be one. NBA, characteristics that make a well-rounded official. Does it surprise you, this one? Excellent communicator. We can't do it enough. Okay? We just can't do it enough. Team-driven. Not individually driven. Team-driven. Crew. Has courage to make the tough call. Start the game, end of the game, doesn't matter. Okay? Matt talked about a couple of things. get the call right, make the tough call, doesn't matter where it happens, has firmness and resoluteness, and has humility. It's not about you, it's about the game. Has humility. True leader, commitment, confidence, composure, character. That's what you want to see in referees. Committed to the game. You guys are all committed because you're right-handed. Congratulations. That's awesome. Confidence in your game. We'll see. We're going to see that hopefully at starting at 4 o'clock today. Okay? And we're going to actually work on some things. And it's going to be great. So between Friday and Sunday, we expect to see some real improvement on the 4th. And a lot of that could be in confidence. Composure during the game. Everyone that talked today talked about composure of referees. Do we lose it? Are we going to handle when things go rough or crazy? Are we going to handle it? And our character. Are we going to throw our partner under the bus? Right? Are we going to stick up for our crews? When we go and watch referees work, are we when they ask us to give some feedback, are we doing a good job with that as well? Our character is something that we only have one chance to make. You want a good character for the rest of your life. Referees are good people for the most part. One guy's out there. Office, that's our I didn't point at you.
It's a long drive from Brandon.
Do not send me there this year.
You told me you never worked there.
I almost went last year. The most successful referees are students of the game.
Almost
won. Students of the game. They watch tape. They watch other referees work. Okay, Mike Thompson. I told him so last night. I don't think you were there. Mike has seen, if he's worked in the men's game, he has seen the tip of every women's game that takes place before. And he was upset this year because Deputy Van at UBC said to us, John, do you want to start at 10-6? Yes, we'll start at 10-6. So Mike comes in, he also has a pop for the Diet Coke. And he comes in, he's third time out, he looks. He's like, oh my God, there's 4 minutes. Said, what the hell happened? He goes down halftime. I said, what time do you guys start the game? I said, 10-6. He goes, it's supposed to be a 6 o'clock game. I said, I know. Mike never disagrees. He comes and watches. He comes to every women's game. And this schedule, I don't know how he does it. He has about 4 different places he lives in during the week. Victoria and Nanaimo and Kelowna. He makes it, he busts his ass to get every game to see the trip off. And that means a lot to the crews that work the women's game. It really does. I'd love to see all the crews try to do that. I know people have responsibilities at home and work. It'd be really nice to support the crews. And the other thing is, if you work the women's game, stay and watch the men's game. Right? Give some support to the guys and girls that are working the men's game. You might not be able to stay for the whole game, but stay and watch. Okay? It'll make you a better referee. You'll see some good basketball, and it'll show you how to be. Like, you'll see some good things that you like. I talked about the smorgasbord here this weekend. I like that, I'm putting it in my game. I like that, I'm putting it in my game. If I don't like that, I'm not putting it in my game. You'll see a couple of things you like, put in your tool belt. Okay? They attend camps. They watch tape. They mentor younger officials. Right? They help younger officials. They sit down with them. They help them. They work games with them. Right? Wonderful when you can work with a young official and you can help them out. It's phenomenal. And they're great partners, right? People like to work with Karen, Reed, and Warren, Morgan, Bill, and Matt.
Okay, John.
Hey guys, I'm on a call official. Rick's one of my favorite partners to work with, and I don't have to bring my whistle.
Coming from a guy who makes 3 calls in each half.
Perfect. One foul, one out of bounds, and one travel. Good referees, they're always early for the game. They're always depending. You never have to be in the locker room going, oh my God, where are they? I didn't get a text. They're early. They're relaxed. They come in, you have a good chat before the game, right? You know they're dependable, so you're not worried about are they on wherever, what bridge you cross, and I don't know the name of Vancouver or But it's a pain, you're there, you're like, okay, we have two officials, should we call somebody, right? Dependable, they're there all the time. They referee to the best of their ability, no matter if it's a grade three game or a university men's game. They give the game what it's worth, right? Those kids have worked hard, they deserve our 100% effort, doesn't matter what the number is long. Hardest game in the world to referee, grade seven girls. Oh my God, you couldn't pay me enough money. If you gave me $1,000, that's what hurt about. They have a sense of humor. They're able to laugh at themselves. They're able to load after the game, have a beer or a pop and a meal, and laugh about some things that happen in the game, right? We're not perfect, but it's how we handle things after the game. And how the best part about, we talked about this, Bill and I have a plan, I think. In the early days, we used to go to the bar for like 5 hours after the game and just talk basketball.
The old row.
We don't do that anymore. People are really, it's a different, right? Things have changed societally. We don't do that anymore. But that's how I learned refereeing, sitting and listening to people talk about what they did, why they made that call, or how they handled that coach, or why they did it. We got to do more of that. And that's why I commend you not to be here this weekend. They have fun on the court. We want to see some smiles this weekend, right? We don't want to see everyone sit. We're not. As you can tell, our group is not very serious about the sex, right? We enjoy each other, we enjoy basketball, and we want you guys to have fun this weekend. So we're gonna have fun on the court with you, and we wanna see, when you're relaxed on the court, you make good calls. And they really care about the game of basketball. Right? You all care about the game of basketball, you wouldn't be here. And that is really reflective of what we do. Here's refereeing 101 in a nutshell. How we deal with people. Okay, players, the coaches. The most important group in the whole gym are who? From a referee's point of view, who is the most important group in the gym? Who? Minor officials. Make or break your game. Make or break your game. Do you have a good relationship with minor officials? Do you go over and talk to them? Right? I bring candy to all my minor officials. In Edmonton, you have to. They tell you, where's the candy? I'm like, holy shit, I forgot. I'll bring it tomorrow. I'm sure for the playoff game this year, and I was like, I do it at my home game, but okay, we'll bring it tomorrow. Bring it double. Okay. No, they're very, very serious now.
Oh, yeah.
And that crew, oh my God, they're just like unbelievable. Matt and the crew in Edmonton. The table.
At U of A.
Yeah, at U of A. Not
it.
Yeah,
leave McEwen out of this. Mitts is a problem.
I want to talk about
this. They're better than Trinity Western?
Are you approachable? Do you actually listen? Right? Sometimes my face says I'm listening. I'm not really listening. I'll be truthful. I'm not the coach. It's like, okay, I'm going to watch for that. Okay? Coach wants acknowledgement. They'll tell us all the time. Acknowledge the coach. Call the coach, I'll watch for that. Yep, got it. Now I'm done. I'm gone. Okay? I'm not standing, I'm not initiating conversations with them. I'm gonna, yep, got the coach, done. I'm not gonna try to explain anything to them. Are you consistent and fair? Are you a team player?